the first lecture of Dr. V.S. Sapkar, he stated about the nanomaterial membranes and their uses for the food security, energy security, and for the filtration purpose. The same thing is used in the nanotechnology for a device-based application. Thin film science is basically a new branch. It is only has an age of 6 to 7 decades. But because of a tremendous and numerical applications in various fields, just like electronic, microelectronic, power electronics, optical devices, sensors, high memory computer elements, storage of solar energy and its conversion to the other forms, magnetic memories, piezoelectric devices, optical filters, micro miniaturization of electronic circuits, space science, aircraft, defense, and all other industries, the devices which we required, it is always in a form of thin film. If we compare the bulk material over the thin film form, then the properties like physicochemical properties are totally changed. And again, as the thickness of the film is changes, the properties are also get changes. Means suppose a bulk material if you take and it shows a conducting properties, means just like a metal. But the same metal, if we deposited in a form of thin film having different thickness using different techniques, the same material can be used as a semiconductor or can be used as a insulator. Means basically the we tailored or we altered the properties of thin film according to our need for the device application. Means which device we want to fabricate, according to this we select the material as well as the fabrication technology of a thin film. Again, these are the different technological applications of the thin film in modern microelectronics, optoelectronic devices, just like we use a cell phone. Or television, we require the cell phone, it must be a slim, it must be a attractive, one touchy, means the screen touch must be a very good. And all these things are appeared with the help of a thin film. Means initially, just like in 98-2000 when the mobiles are just launched, at that time the cost of the mobiles are very high. The screen size, it is only of about less than 1 inch, and it is a bulky, the weight of that mobiles or cell phone, it is very very large. But nowadays the mobiles which we use or the cell phones which we use, these are very handy, slim, attractive, and the screen is also, we get a different types of screen like Gorilla screen, then the scratch proof or waterproof, resistance proof screen. These are all obtained with the help of a thin film technologies. Means if we take a electronic component in a bulk form, then the size of a device becomes large, it consumes large power. But if the same devices, either it may be an active device or passive device, if we fabricate it in terms of a thin film, then because of the compactness of the thin film, reliable and low weight, low packaging is required, and the low energy is required, and hence the thin film devices are preferred over the bulk counterparts. Okay. To prepare the thin film, the conventional method used is nothing but a synthesis of co-melting a mixture of a given stoichiometry. Means simple example, suppose I want a zinc oxide. Then we take a zinc and oxygen in 1:1 atomic proportion and we co-melt it and we get a zinc oxide in a bulk form. But the characteristics of this zinc oxide, it is insulating properties, it shows the insulating properties. But the same zinc oxide, when we use in a thin film form, it shows a semiconducting nature. The aim of this study is to establish the fabrication of alloy in thin film form, which are expected to be a key component in semiconducting material for the use of ultra high speed transistor, complementary MOSFET technology, as well as in solar cell and gas sensor applications. The deposition technique is greatly affected by the deposition environment. The deposition parameter includes the deposition substrate, the which type of substrate we have to take. It may be a insulating substrate, non-insulating substrate, alloy, steel, or any other substrate we can use for the deposition of a material. The second one is a temperature maintain, whether we have to deposit the film at room temperature or at a particular substrate temperature, then the pressure, whether we have to deposit the film at atmospheric pressure or reduced pressure. When we deposit the film at the atmospheric pressure, at that time there is a possibility of contamination. The atmospheric contamination, just like some gas molecules, are also get suppressed in the deposits, and hence the quality of the film is also gets affected. Now, how we can prepare the material? Basically, I here give the two methods. One is a thermal vacuum evaporation method, and another one is a Sillar method for the deposition of thin film. For thermal deposition of thin film, we required a composite materials, and these composite materials we fabricate using a melt quench method. Here we take a CDS as a directly pure material, but when we have to deposit the bismuth selenide material, then this material is prepared in the form of ingot using a melt quench method. In this melt quench method, we take a high purity bismuth powder and the selenium powder in an evacuated quartz ampoule. And this quartz ampoule is then sealed under a pressure of about 10⁻⁶ torr, and then this ampoule is kept at a temperature of 970 Kelvin in a double zone rotating furnace for 12 hours, and then it is kept out, and then it is kept in a ice cooled water so that the ingot is quenched. And then this material is taken out, and then that material is crushed and used for the preparation of thin films. In a same manner, the cadmium selenide is prepared. Only the temperature is same, but the time required, it is 48 hours. And the second technique, here we use the uranium sulfide or uranium sulfide replaced by silver sulfide by Sillar technique. Basically, there are number of types of deposition methods are there, but all these methods are broadly classified into four types as a physical vapor deposition method, sputtering, chemical vapor deposition, and a chemical deposition. Sorry. In a physical vapor deposition, the primary requirement is a vacuum. The material which we have to deposit must be deposited under a vacuum of about 10⁻⁵ torr or more than that. And in this method, the material is directly evaporates or sublimates by passing the current through the refractory material in which we keep the material which we have to deposit, and the material is sublimates in the form of vapor, and then this vapor stream are condensed on the substrate. Again, there are the different types of physical vapor deposition methods are given there. The second method is a sputtering. In this sputtering method, we take a material which we have to deposit in the form of electrode, and the high energetic particles are bombarded on that electrode so that the atoms or molecules get ejected from that electrode, and then it is deposited on the substrate. The third method is a chemical vapor deposition technique. In this method, there is a thermal decomposition of atoms or molecule takes place using either thermal or chemical reaction. And the next method is a chemical deposition method. It is the very simplest and low cost method everyone can perform by using only few beakers, distilled water, and required chemical. You can perform this chemical deposition technique to prepare the thin films of any material. It may be a metal, alloys, or compound materials. We can deposit using this chemical deposition technique. Now, which deposition technique is we have to select? For this, there are some parameters are there. The deposition technique which we select, it must deposit any kind of material. It may be a metal, semiconductor, alloy, or complex chemical compound. Any type of material must be deposited by that deposition technique. The second one is ability to form the deposits according to our need. Means sometimes we need a single crystal material for a certain particular application like filters. Sometimes we require the material must be a polycrystalline for optoelectronics or for the sensing applications. We require the polycrystalline materials, and sometimes we require the materials which must be amorphous, and hence the ability to deposit the material in the form of either crystalline, polycrystalline, or amorphous. Again, the next and the important one is a stoichiometry. The deposition technique must maintain the stoichiometry of the materials which we use in the deposition. Then good growing power and the reliable adhesion. I mean, just like simple experiment is done by our mothers or foremothers, when there is a small children is there, they made a kajal by taking a diya. The films is deposited on that utensil or on that material, that is also a thin film, but that thin film, it is not having a good adhesion. Means if you take just like this, the material which is deposited, it is easily removed. And hence, the material which is deposited, it must be a well adhered. And the ability of repetition means the same parameter, if we keep, then the films must be growing repeated again and again, having the same stoichiometry, having the same parameter, which is the basic requirement for the device application. And all these basic parameters are met in either thermal vacuum evaporation technique or in a chemical deposition technique. Here we use a thermal vacuum evaporation technique in which this is the vacuum system which produces a vacuum of about 10 raised to minus 6 Pascal or 10 raised to minus 6 torr, millibar or torr. In this system is basically divided into three types. One, there is a bell jar is there. The second one is a main pump is there. And the third one, which is denoted by M, that one is nothing but a oil seal or rotary pump is there. The main pump, it is nothing but a vapor diffusion pump, which is a three-stage vapor diffusion pump. It produces the vacuum of about 10 raised to minus 5 torr, but the push-up is required to get the more vacuum, and hence we use here the oil seal or rotary pump, which generates the base pressure of 10 raised to minus 3 torr. But by combining this both the pumping system, we get the ultimate pressure of about 10 raised to minus 6 millibar. Now, while depositing the material, there must be the surface on which surface we have to deposit, that substrate or that surface must be clean, because that substrate, it may possess some dust or grease or any type of contaminations are there, these may be first removed. And for this purpose, there is a standard procedure is there. Here, the gross contamination is first removed by using a detergent solution. Then it is, these slides are again cleaned with the help of a double distilled water and then agitated for 20 minutes in a ultrasonic bath. Then these slides are again thoroughly rinsed with a double distilled water, and then it is again cleaned with the help of alcohol, which is used AR grade. And then these slides are kept in a vacuum agitator. The thickness of the film is also one of the most important parameter, because it also defines the different parameters and the device quality, and hence it is useful to measure the thickness and to control the thickness. We use here the quartz crystal thickness monitor. Now, for the growth parameter, there must be required some optimum condition. The first one is a board or a refractory material through in which we kept the material and then we sublimate the material. Here we use the refractory material or board made up of molybdenum material. It has a capacity to pass a current of about 200 ampere. Then the base pressure is kept 10 raised to minus 5 millibar. The substrate to source distance is kept 10 centimeter, and here the size of the glass slide is also given. and the deposition rate is maintained 5 to 10 angstrom per second, and it is maintained with the help of quartz crystal thickness monitor. And all the depositions are taken at room temperature, and afterwards the post-heat treatment is also given. Now, after deposition of the thin film, their characterizations are important. To make this characterization, basically the characterization are basically divided into three types. The first one is the structural and surface morphological property of a film, which can be determined with the help of X-ray diffraction technique, scanning electron microscope technique, then atomic force microscope technique. Again, there are transmission electron microscope, and number of techniques are there, but here we use SEM, TEM and AFM and XRD for the surface morphological study. And to study the electronic transport properties, the four probe technique, then the thermoelectric power measurement are used for determining the activation energy, resistivity, mobility, carrier concentration, and the type of charge carrier. We use the Hall measurement. Means there are different types of method for the measurement of electrical resistivity, basically classified into four types. One is a direct method, another is a two-point method, the third one is a four-point method, or simply called as a four-probe method. And if the surface is irregular shape and irregular geometry, then we use a van der Waal method. As here the thin film is used, it has a fixed geometry, fixed shape, and hence we use here the four-probe resistivity measurement, since here the contact resistance is not played. In a direct method or in a two-probe method, ohmic contacts are made, and because of this ohmic contact, we doesn't get the actual resistivity. And hence we use here the four-point probe method, in which here the four probes are used. All the probes having the equidistance, the inner two probes are used for the current measurement, and the outer probes are used for the voltage measurement. And we can measure the resistivity from 0 degree centigrade to about 200 degree centigrade, means high temperature and low temperature resistivity both can be measured using this resistivity measurement kit. But the main drawback is this: which type of the charge carrier are present, either electron means negative type or holes means positive type. These are not confirmed with the help of a four-point probe method, and hence to determine the charge carrier concentration, we use this Hall method. In this Hall method, the sample is kept within the perpendicular magnetic and electric field, so that because of this magnetic and electric field, the EMF is generated. And this EMF, it is generated, it is perpendicular to both magnetic as well as electric field. And by using that magnetic field, EMF, we can calculate the Hall mobility, carrier concentration, type of charge carrier, and all other things we can calculate. The third one is a thermoelectric power measurement, or it is also called as a Seebeck effect. If the temperature difference or temperature gradient is maintained between the two ends of conductor or semiconductor, then the EMF is generated, and that EMF we call this as a thermo EMF. And according to this thermo EMF, we can also find out the value of Fermi energy scattering coefficient, and also it is a confirmative test of a Hall effect, means the type of charge carrier, whether it is N type or P type, it can be again confirmed with the help of this thermoelectric power measurement setup. Now, these are the surface morphological property. Okay. Now, here basically I focus on the cadmium sulfide, bismuth selenide, and then uranium sulfide. Okay. Now, the cadmium sulfide, we take here the direct pure material, and that pure material is evaporate with the help of a molybdenum boat as a refractory material, and we calculate the thickness is varied from 500 angstrom to 4000 angstrom, means from 50 nanometer to 400 nanometer the thickness is varied, and we found that the CDS film has a preferential orientation at 040, means we get the HKL parameter using this XRD. Again, the films possesses the number of small peaks are also obtained there. These peaks, the large number of these small peaks shows that the films deposited, it is again a polycrystalline in nature. Again, as the thickness it changes from 50 nanometer to 400 nanometer, the intensity very much changes. But as the material is same, the peak is not get shifted. Then in this pure CDS, we dope the selenium material in a very small amount using the melt quench method, and also by using a two source evaporation method. Means in one boat we take a CDS material, and in another boat we take a selenium material, and both the materials are sublimate at a time on the glass substrate, and the stoichiometry is maintained such as CDS AC we get. In this we found that in a previous we get the peak at 040, it is at near about 24 degree, but when the selenium is incorporated in CDS, the peak is also get shifted, as well as the structure is also get changes. The HKL value we get 100, and the peak is shifted near about at 26 degree centigrade, and also the structure is shifted from hexagonal to monoclinic. Again, the surface morphology we have to taken out using the scanning electron microscope, and we found that for the cadmium sulfide, the surface morphology is found to be a granular, and some spherical particles are also seen there. And again, the size of the particle, it is within 6 to 10 nanometer is found. And here some particles are found to be of large size. Here you see these particles in the first figure, some particles are of large size. These large particles are formed because of the collisions of the small particles, and we get a large particle. Again, here we get the CDS AC film. In this CDS AC film, we get a fractured morphology. We get a fractured morphology, and in this fractured morphology, there are some holes and voids you can see, and these holes and voids can be used as a pores to pass the liquid or gases which we want to detect. And a particular gas, by using a heterojunction, means this particularly this CDS SE or CDS, these are the N-type material, and to this N-type material, if we dope the P-type material, and a heterojunction is made by using N-type and P-type material, then, and if we pass the gas through this N-type material, then through these pores, these gases goes from N-type to P-type region, and accordingly, there is a change in occur in the current voltage characteristics, and from that characteristics, we can determine whether this material can be used for the sensing of a particular gas. Again, the surface roughness cannot be found using the scanning electron microscope, and hence the atomic force microscopy is taken, and by using this atomic force microscopy, we found to be the surface roughness for the cadmium sulfide film, it is of about 25 nanometer, while for the selenium incorporated cadmium sulfide thin film, it is found to be only 16 nanometer, and hence, as the surface roughness is very, very small, these films can also be used for the optoelectronic devices, as well as in solar cell application, we can also use this cadmium sulfide and the cadmium selenium incorporated cadmium sulfide thin films. Again, this EDAX confirms the elemental ratio of the cadmium and sulfide. The stoichiometry, it is near about obtained as 1:1. Here, the cadmium ratio, it is obtained 51% and the sulfur, it is obtained of about 48 to 49%, means the stoichiometry is nearly maintained. And again, here the cadmium selenide sulfur film, again the stoichiometry is maintained, and we get the required result. By using the only the surface morphological property shows us the films are used for which purpose. But actually, again, there are the optical band gap and the electrical band gap and activation energy, these are also plays important role in selecting a particular thin film for a device application. And hence, to determine the optical band gap, we use a UV visible NIR spectrometer, and by using this UV visible NIR spectrometer, we got the optical band gap as well as optical absorption coefficient using the torque relation, which is nothing but h nu is equal to A times h nu minus E g raised to n, where h nu, it is nothing but a photon, light. Means on the film, we incident a light or a photon of a particular wavelength. Now, when this light or photon is incident on the wavelength, it may be absorbed or it may be get transmitted. And by measuring this absorption or transmission, one can calculate the optical band gap of the thin film and the optical absorption coefficient. Also, we can calculate the extinction coefficient, reflectivity, and the refractive index of the material is also calculated by using this optical properties of the material. In the CDS and CDS SE thin film, here the absorption versus wavelength is given. Here we vary the wavelength of light from 200 to about 900 nanometer, and the particular absorption is measured, and we found that the absorption is maximum at about 350 to 450 nanometer, we get the maximum absorption for the cadmium sulfide film, while for the cadmium selenium incorporated cadmium sulfide thin film, it is near about 300 to 350 nanometer. And by using this, again the transmission we calculate, and the transmission is found to be more than 95% in the cadmium sulfide films and about 90% in a selenium incorporated films, and by using this we calculate the optical band gap by extrapolating the graph of h nu versus absorption coefficient. We found that the cadmium sulfide and the cadmium selenium incorporated cadmium selenide possesses a direct band gap, means the electron or holes which goes directly from valence band to the conduction band. And this band gap, it is obtained for cadmium selenide, it is of about 2.4 electron hold, while for the selenium, the cadmium sulfide, it is obtained of about 2.6 to 2.9 electron hold. And according to this band gap, we can also use the material for different applications. Now again, here the XRD confirms the nature, it is a polycrystalline nature. The crystallinity again depends on the thickness. As we increase the thickness, the crystallinity is also gets improved. Again, the diffraction process incorporated the growth of the material, and again we found that the full width half maxima, means in this FWHM, see, in this full width half maxima, we see that as the thickness is increases, the width at the half of this X-ray, at this peak, the width is goes on decreasing. Means as the FWHM is decreases, as the width is increases, it shows that there are some defects are there. In the fin, some defects are also present. And these defects are because of the lattice imperfection within the film. Also, there are some micro strains are also available within these films. The strain we can also calculate using the particle size calculated using the XRD, using Scherer formula as 0.9 lambda upon beta cos theta, where beta is nothing but a full width half maxima, lambda is nothing but a wavelength of XRD, we can calculate, and 2 theta means the peak obtained at the preferential or the dominant peak obtained 2 theta we take, and from this we can get the grain size of the film. Okay. Now the second one is a bismuth selenide film. Again, the bismuth selenide films are deposited by using the same technique. By using first melt quench method, we first make the compound or the ingot of a material, then that ingot is taken out and it is made up in a film. Now here, in this bismuth selenide films, we get a big hump. We get a big hump at the initial, from 20 to near about 40, we get a big hump. And afterwards, at near about 43 degree, we get a large peak. And by using this large peak, it is corresponding to the 109 HKL values, means it is a dominant peak, and which appears proves the microcrystalline nature of a thin film. Again, the face of a film is appear to be hexagonal crystal structure. But this big hump is obtained, which are shows that the bismuth and selenium incorporation, these are not in a particular stoichiometry. Means somewhere the stoichiometry is distorted. And because of this distortion of stoichiometry, we get a big hump. Again, the lattice parameter, as the crystal structure is hexagonal, one can find out the values of A, B, C, and the unit cell volume is also calculated using the solid state physics or using the solid state chemistry. There are the standard formulas are there for the different crystal structure. By using this standard formulas, we can calculate the lattice parameters A and C and the corresponding unit cell volume. It is found to be 345. Again, the structural parameters like strain, dislocation density and micro number of lines in the dislocation, these are also calculated by using the Scherer formula. First, we calculate the grain size 0.9 lambda upon beta cos theta. By using this, we can calculate the first the particle size or grain size, and after calculating the grain size, by taking the square of the reciprocal of the that grain size, we get the strain, that is we found to be 10.37 into 10 raised to 15 lines per centimeter square. Means within 1 centimeter square, the number of dislocation lines are found to be of about 10 raised to 15. Also, the number of atoms present in a unit cell or unit cell volume, it is found to be of about 10 raised to 17, and the strain is obtained of about 10 raised to minus 3. Now here we get the small value of delta, also the strain, and this confirms the good crystallinity of the films. Again here we find out the surface morphological properties, and we calculate the granular size. In a bismuth selenide film, the surface morphology, it is found to be uniform, means all the particles are uniformly distributed over the surface. There are no fractures or pinholes are found. Also, the size of the particle, it is varying from 10 to 12 nanometer. Again, we take the cross-sectional view to find out the whether this material, it is used for which type of application and what is its thickness. We control the thickness. For this purpose, we also take the cross-sectional view. Again, the surface roughness for the bismuth selenide film, it is calculated using the atomic force microscopy, and it is found to be of about 25 nanometer. Now here also we get the surface roughness less, and hence these films are used in a sensor application, particularly in a light sensor application, in UV sensor, ultraviolet sensor, as well as in optoelectronic devices, we can use this bismuth selenide material. Also, the bismuth, it is a magnetic material, hence as the magnetic property, as we change the magnetic field and measure the corresponding current and voltage parameter, then you found that the magnetic field or the magnetic resistance is also get changed. And hence, in a high field magnetron or in a magnetoresistance, also we can use this bismuth selenide thin films. Again, the optical characteristics, here we done with the help of UV visible spectrophotometer as well as using fluorescence meter. Using the UV visible spectrophotometer, we get the band gap of the bismuth selenide film. It is found to be varied with respect to thickness, and for the lower thickness, the band gap is found to be 1.4 electron volt, but as the thickness is goes on increasing, the band gap is also goes on increasing, and it is appeared to be of about near about 2.25 electron volt. Means the lower thickness 1.4 electron volt, this is nothing but a visible range of a solar light. And hence the lower thickness of the film, these are also used for the solar cell application or the photovoltaic application. And the higher thickness films we can use for the sensing application and for the optoelectronic devices application. Again, the last graph shows the photoluminescence spectra. Here we take the emission spectra. The emission spectra here shows the two peaks. One peak is obtained at near about 598 nanometer, and the another peak is obtained at 675 nanometer, near about 675 nanometer. And the corresponding wavelength, the corresponding energy to this peak, we can calculate using the formula Sc upon lambda. Here h is a Planck's constant, c is a velocity of light, and lambda we can calculate by using this graph. We can get the lambda. By using this, the first peak, which is obtained at 598 nanometer, which corresponding to the wavelength of 2 electron hole. And so this emission is occurred to be H type emission, means H to H, means the electron or hole, which whatever may be the charges, this goes from the donor, from the highest of the donor level to the bottom of the acceptor level, the electron jumps. And hence we call this as a H transmission, H to H transmission. Again, with the second peak, it is obtained at 671 nanometer. Now, as the wavelength gets shifted, it means that the band gap is reduced. Wavelength is larger, means lambda is larger, and hence the band gap is decreases, and hence this emission can be attributed to the radiative emission, means during this transmission, some of the electrons becomes free. And because of this free electron, they again come, they remain sometime in the conduction band and again come back to the valence band. But when they come, at that time they emit the energy in the form of either heat or light, and hence this emitted energy, it is nothing but a radiative decay type of energy is found to be there. Again, the electronic transport properties are also affect the device performance, means whether the conductivity, whether that device conduct the current or not, how much amount of current is conduct by that film or by that device, that one is also important. And hence, to determine this electric transport properties, we perform here the four probe and the thermoelectric power measurement. Using this four probe method is a unique method to determine the activation energy. Activation energy, it is basically nothing but a measure of energy required to excite the electron from donor level to the conduction band, or from acceptor to the acceptor level from the valence band for n type and p type material. For n type material, donor level to the conduction band, and for p type material, it is from valence band to the acceptor level. Okay, there, from this we can calculate the activation energy using the formula rho is equal to rho zero exponential of delta E upon kT. And we found that the activation energy goes on increasing as the thickness of the film goes on increasing. But again, as the activation energy is related to the conductivity mechanism, means higher the conductivity, it means that we require the lower energy to activate the electron. Okay? And hence the charge carrier basically generally needed no low activation energy for the higher conducting material. Again, the thermoelectric power measurement is done, and by using this thermoelectric power measurement, we calculate the Fermi energy by taking the slope and intercept of the large graph Seebeck coefficient versus reciprocal of absolute temperature, hot end temperature. We can calculate by using the slope and the y-axis interpolation, we can calculate the Fermi energy as well as scattering coefficient, and these values are given in this table. Now again, for this XRD confirms the films are polycrystalline in nature, having hexagonal structure. Again, the surface morphology is homogeneous and granular morphology is obtained. The AFM study shows the surface is homogeneous, having a very low roughness, and the activation energy is found to be increased with increase in temperature, and the values are obtained from 0.03 electron volt to about 0.07 electron volt. Means this material is used, we can use for the different applications. Okay. Now, the second one is first report on SILAR. Deposited uranium sulfide or uranyl sulfide thin film and its chemical conversion to the silver sulfide thin film. Now, SILAR. SILAR is basically nothing but successive ionic layer adsorption and reaction method. In this method, successive adsorption of metallic ion and reaction with chalcogenide ion takes place. This method is suitable for large area deposition. And using this method, the number of materials we can deposit, but we first report the uranium sulfide using SILAR technique and its chemical conversion to the silver sulfide thin film, and this paper is just accepted in the Applied Surface Science having impact factor 3.65. In this method, what we have to do? In one beaker, we take a uranium solution having a particular molar capacity, and in another beaker, we take the sulfur precursor. First, yeah, here given, sir. Here we use the uranium 10 millimole, which is dissolved in 50 ml deionized water with continuous stirring. And in another beaker, we take sodium sulfide, 4% sodium sulfide, which is dissolved in 50 ml deionized water. And by using this continuous stirring, first we dip the film for 10 seconds in uranium solution, then that film is taken out, and then it is dip in a double distilled water for 10 seconds. Then it is again dip in the sodium sulfide solution for 10 seconds, then taken out, and then it is deposited, then it is dip in a double distilled water. And the same cycles are repeated for 30, 50, 80 cycles are taken in a same manner so that the fins we get. Now, after deposition, we get the uranyl sulfide fins. Then these uranyl sulfide fins are kept in 10 millimole silver nitrate film for 2 hours and 24 hours in controlled conditions so that the uranyl is completely replaced by silver. Now here we take the XRD for the uranium sulfide fins, that we get the number of peaks which confirms the fins are polycrystalline in nature, but the 2 theta peaks observed at 25 degree centigrade, 25 degree, 28, 29, 30 and 35 degree exhibit the formation of orthorhombic structure of uranyl sulfide, which corresponding to the 103 plane, 113 plane, and these corresponding planes of reflections are given there. Now the average grain size is again calculated by using again the Scherer formula, and it is found to be 17.6 nanometer. And again the HKL parameter ABC values are also given here. Now, when these uranyl sulfide fins are kept in a silver nitrate solution for 24 hours, then uranyl is completely replaced by silver, which we can confirm using this XRD data. Again, in this XRD data, we get the number of peaks shows the fins are again the polycrystalline in nature, and the 2 theta peaks are obtained at 22, 25, 27, 31 and 40 degree shows the monoclinic phase of silver sulfide, means the uranyl sulfide, which is obtained the orthorhombic structure, but when it is placed in a silver nitrate solution for 24 hours, the uranyl is replaced by the silver, and then the phase is also changes from orthorhombic to monoclinic. Again, for the 30 cycle, the same morphology is taken out using same for the 30 cycle. We get here the morphology, it is almost uniform, and the particles are obtained to be granular morphology, and these are the pores nature. In the morning lecture, Dr. V.S. Sapkai shows why the membranes are useful for the fabrication of sensors. Here the structure we get, here the porous structure is obtained. There are the pores are there through which we can pass the gas through the heterojunction, and hence we can use this also as a gas sensing properties. This is for the 30 cycle. Here we get the particle size from 4 nanometer to 23 nanometer. Again, when we take the 50 cycle, the morphology get changes. Here we get the ice cube type morphology or mud like morphology is obtained. And this mud-like morphology we can use for the, as there is a diffuse radiations are there, then this diffuse radiation can be captured by using this mud-like morphology, and hence when the diffuse radiations comes from the sun, this diffuse radiation we can also convert into the electrical energy using such type of morphology. Again, for 80 cycle, we get the nanograins, but these nanograins are found to be smoother, but again here the spores are obtained with some voids are also found. These voids we can also use for doping another material to change the property of the substance, and we can use this for the sensor application also. Now when we replace the uranyl sulfide with the silver sulfide for 2 hours, we get the surface morphology find to be a completely uniform, but again some holes and voids are seen, which can be we use for doping the materials. Okay. For 24 hours, we get the morphology completely membrane-like morphology is obtained, where the nanoparticles are plugging together, interconnected together, and the grain size is obtained from 15 to 34 nanometer again there. Again, we calculate the optical band gap of both uranyl sulfide and silver sulfide thin film, and we found that for the uranyl sulfide, the band gap is very, very low, from 0.5 to 1.1 electron volt. As the band gap is low, we can use it for the rectification purpose, micro miniaturization of the computers and high memory elements in a computer. We can use this uranyl sulfide films also to control the nuclear reaction. We can use this uranyl sulfide thin film. Again, sometime we required we can also get the morphology just like a nanotubes, and through this nanotube morphology the currents or the particles can be easily sent, and again this can be used for the super capacitor purpose. Generally when we use internet in our smartphone, the battery goes, but the battery dies within 3 to 4 hours. Am I right or wrong? Yes. But when we use such type of morphology in the batteries, means in a super capacitor, then the charging time of battery requires only less than 1 second, means your battery can charge within 1 second and it can remains charged for few months. It can remains charged for few months if even though you utilize all the functions of your cell phones. And hence for the fabrication of the super capacitor, we required such type of morphology. Okay, here the gas sensing mechanism is given. Here the heterojunction type of mechanism is used, where the barrier potential is required and there is no adsorption or the desorption of oxygen is required. Basically in membrane type there is a oxygen, there is a absorption or desorption of oxygen is there, but as we use the heterojunction, there is no need of the oxygen absorption and desorption. Again, the heterojunction used in a forward bias, and hence the sensitivity to a particular gas can be calculated easily using a small forward bias current or voltage, and the sensitivity can be calculated using this formula. Okay, here we fabricate the N type CDS and P type polyaniline heterojunction, and we get the IV characteristic, current voltage characteristic for the gas. Here we use only 0.15% volume of gas, and we get the maximum response of about 56%, and the response time is only 80 to 300 seconds, and the gas recovery time is of about 600 seconds, and the ideality factor and the rectification ratio is also given there. Here there is a schematic diagram for the gas sensor unit which we use in our lab, it is given. Okay, thanks for your attention. Okay, here just 1 minute. Here the how we make this LPG gas sensor. Here we use a spherical granular N-type CDS, which I have shown there, and the N-type polyaniline, it is fabricated using a potentiodynamic mode. Here the precursor which we use, it is a 0.5 mole sulfuric acid and 0.45 mole aniline is taken, and the potential is kept from minus 0.2 to 8.8 volt, and the saturated calomel electrode is used, and the scan rate is kept 50 to 50 millivolt per second, and pH is maintained between 3 to 4. Here we get, see, the nanofibrous pani, it means polyaniline, it acts as a membrane through which the gas is entered. See, before and after exposure, before exposing, the gas is coming through this interfacial layer between this N-type, P-type polyaniline and N-type CDS, and through this interfacial layer, when the gas comes, the height of the potential barrier get changes, and according to that change in barrier height, we can calculate the particular selectivity of a gas. Okay, thanks for your attention. There are number of is there. Thanks for your attention.